Good morning. Welcome to the Lord's house today. What a great gift God has given us in this being Mission Sunday. It is a time where we look to how we serve our communities, be it here at St. Paul or out in the world. And today we are serving our world with mission packs, or backpacks, and quilts. So we are going to be praying for these and also the gifts of God that he continues to pour out on his church. So and we will use the mission money for those things as well. So we keep the idea of Christ's mission alive here at St. Paul and out there in the world. I do, because it's Mission Sunday, that means there's a lot of special things which you need to be aware of. The first is that there is going to be a bell choir. The bell choir plays after the Old Testament reading and the choir itself. That is a great time. Also, hymn 833. That is the sermon hymn. I want you to grab your hymnals right now because sometimes we just need to be led a little bit more. Turn to 833. This is the song, Listen, God is Calling, and it is done in parts. So I will do the leader part, and you guys will do the part that says all. So if you look there at the very beginning, I will do the listen, and then you will do the listen, God is calling. And then down further down at the next two stanzas, you'll see Jesus gave his mandate. That's the leader part. And then you guys do the response. Okay? You guys are professional grade. You can do this. You can do this. So that's on that note. And then a final note for this is that, not a final note, the closing hymn, they will know they are Christians by our love. In late service, we are going to have stanzas 2 and 3 sung by our youth. As long as there's enough youth here to sing, I got two up here. They'll go over to the back. So you guys are in senior youth, so it's not you guys. If you didn't get something to sing, you're not singing. Right. But nonetheless, these are those things that are gifted to you. And finally, inside the bulletin, there's another insert, and that is the prayer that we do for the Lutheran World Relief quilts and backpacks. So that's going to take place just before the prayers of the church, and then I will have you respond to those that prayer right there for the quilts. If you don't have one in your bulletin, somebody took it. There should be a bulletin out there with them, or your neighbor might have an extra. So blessings on the service today. We're going to have the singing of our first hymn and the ringing of the bells. But first, let us rise and greet one another with the peace of God. rise, turning to page 203 for invocation and the confession and absolution. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But we do hear His forgiveness, therefore you are here.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon Him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the sacrament, in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness, and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as His people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking His grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His Son to die for you, and for His sake He forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by His authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His steadfast love endures forever. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Glory be to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. For His steadfast love endures forever. Lord, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you gave your Son into the hands of sinful men who killed him. Forgive us when we reject your unfailing love, and grant us the fullness of your salvation. through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the readings. The Old Testament reading for the 19th Sunday after Pentecost is taken from Isaiah chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. And he looked for it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I looked for it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I shall break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and briars and thorns shall grow up. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are his pleasant planting. And he looked for justice, and behold, bloodshed. For righteousness, and behold, an outcry. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you.
I'm even smiling more deeply on the inside. Our epistle reading for today is taken from Philippians chapter 3, beginning at verse 4. St. Paul writes, "If anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness, under the law, blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this, or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of Christ in God, of God in Christ Jesus." Man, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise for the gospel and the verse. Alleluia. Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And this is also the verse for our basis for our sermon today. Jesus said, "Hear another parable. There was a master of a house who planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a wine press in it and built a tower and leased it to his tenants. And then went into another country. When the season for fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to get his fruit. And the tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other servants, more than the first, and they did the same thing to them. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and have his inheritance.' And they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. When, therefore, the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants, who will give him the fruits in their seasons." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes.' Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush him." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived that he was speaking about them. And although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds because they held him to be a prophet. This is the word, this is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We continue now by turning to page 207 as we joyfully get to confess our faith together through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The congregation may be seated for our sermon hymn 833, and just a reminder for that one that has a leader portion, and then it has a portion for all the people to sing, so just keep track of that as we go through it. Gave his mandate,
share the good news,
that he came to save us,
and set us free.
Listen, listen, God is calling, through the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort and joy. Let none be forgotten,
throughout the world.
In the triune name of God,
go and baptize.
Listen, listen, God is calling, through the word inviting, offering forgiveness,
comfort.
Help us to be faithful,
standing,
walking in your precepts,
led by your word.
Listen, listen, God is calling. What a glorious day. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Our text for today's sermon is taken from our gospel reading in Matthew. And the sermon is entitled, Let Us Produce the Fruits of Resurrection. Some 700 years before Jesus, God sent Isaiah, the prophet, to tell God's people, Israel, a love story. And Jesus loved this story so much that he told it, the story over again to his people in Jerusalem when he came. And the old, old story, the old, old parable, is not meant to just be mere history. And Jesus tells us our story. So hear another parable. Listen again. Do you see what God has done to create us, to sustain us, and to give us life? There was a master of a house who planted a vineyard. Deliberately, for each of us, the Lord rooted the earth. Tenderly, he planted so that his prized possession, his people, would have joyful wine Then the master put a fence around his vineyard. The Lord's teaching, encircling his people, encircling what God has created, protecting God's people through his word, because there is a jungle out there. And the master dug a wine press. Every good drop he will squeeze out. And the Lord desires to drink of his glorious wine press with his people. From there he built a watchtower, a high place, standing high upon God's word. And there, from there, he oversees the big picture. God did everything to make sure his wine vineyard was fruitful. And then the master leased the vineyard to tenants. He is eager for us to have his benefits, the benefits from his work. The good Lord delights in giving good gifts. He delights in us receiving and using and sharing his good gifts. He is giving and giving and giving, kind of that rippling out effect, right? It just keeps coming. And that makes sense because our God is a giver of every good and perfect gift. And now, when the season for the fruit to draw near was come, he sent his servants to the tenants to get the fruit. What goodly share would these grateful tenants gladly return to their glorious master for such a great gift? Rightfully, their Lord was worth receiving every bit of it. But he says, no, just a portion. What takes place next is the ringing of the bells. No, that's not what takes place next. What takes place next only makes sense to corrupt hearts. The tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. And he sent other servants, more than the first, and they did the same to them. This happened. The owner sent his servants in two groups, and we biblical scholars would call them the former prophets and the latter prophets. And what happened to them? So many stories, all telling the same story. Jeremiah was beaten and imprisoned. The great Isaiah himself, they stuck him in a hollow of a tree and sawed the tree in two. Zechariah, they stoned to death, even in the Lord's temple, in his courtyard. Then there is the greatest of the Old Testament prophets, John the Baptizer. And we know what they did to him. Why? Because of greed? In our world today, we see conflicts between landlords and renters. That does happen. In Jesus' day, many of his fellow Jews were poor, and they were working out there in the fields under the heat of the day, under the wealthy whips and chains, or wealthy landowners that were the Roman Empire, those pagans. But Jesus' story strongly suggests a darker plot, not greed. These tenants schemed to take as their own what was only loaned to them. They conspired to make themselves the master, to make themselves God. Could Jesus be describing us? Are we so zealous to protect our own things? When God, by the people he puts into our lives, calls us to do the work that he has given to us, what do we say? This is mine. My time, my talents, my treasures. This is my life, my living, and I'm going to do it my way. Would we take as our own what has only been loaned to us? Would we say, that is mine? There, that thing in your hand that's only going to last the day? St. James reminds us, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father. St. Paul contends, what do you have that you did not receive. Time and again, we do not use God's gifts as he declares, as he desires. We close our ears to his servants, even beat them and say, well, who do they think they are coming to try to take my stuff? Given all that the Lord of the harvest has given, all that he has lavished on us, does now the delicious grape that we take in our mouth taste as sour with complaint? Can one live so selfishly? What more can the good Lord do? Finally, the master sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. Was the owner really that stupid? They will respect my son, unarmed as he goes. God not only knew his son would die, God proposed his son's death. This is an unbelievable but true picture of God's patience, grace, and mercy. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and have the inheritance. And they took him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Why would killing the son give them the inheritance? They figure the owner never comes. We got away with killing his messengers. And now the old fool sent his only son. He has nothing left. And guess what? We, the squatters, will become the heirs. Jesus tells this story on Tuesday. 3 days later, on Friday, his hearers took Jesus, threw him out of Jerusalem, and killed him on the cross. In Jesus' parable, the tenant farmers kill the son precisely because he is the son. The high priest Caiaphas and his crew, in the twisted alliance with the Pharisees, they had an idea. They go, huh, Jesus, we didn't know you are the Son of God. Only if we would have known. Jesus insisted, my words and my works tell the truth about who I am. Israel's leaders did know who Jesus was. As they shouted, he claims to be the Son of God. They knew who he was and what his claim was. Jesus' truth was their murderous charge. What about us? Do we know Jesus? You hear the word of God preached to you most Sundays, many Sundays, some Sundays. You see the Son of God at work for you in the waters of baptism, at the communion rail where he gives you his body and blood freely for your forgiveness and life. You see the gift of the cross of Christ where there is death and resurrection life poured out for you every week. Still, I am tired of being accountable to someone else. I just want my own life. How I would love to be the master of my own domain, be free at last. See, we don't worry about money. We worry about wanting to be God. And the parable unmasks the heart of our damnable desires. And it's the same desire that gripped the Old Testament. Because we kill the son. We kill the heir. And you would tell me, right? This is what you say. I don't want to throw Jesus out of my life. I'm not a killer. Jesus laughs. Your sins nailed me to the cross. We moan. I did the work. The fruit is my own. So we refuse to give over to God what belongs to him. You guys think it's all about money? It's not. It's about our lives. It's about the lives of our children. about the lives of our friends and neighbors, are speaking his truth. Instead, we claim, it is my life, I have earned it, so we reject the one who has claim on us by his death and resurrection. And then Jesus asks, what then, therefore, will the owner do? When he comes, what will he do to those killer tenants? And the question is a pretty simple one, right? You know justice. You know what justice looks like. Even the accused here in our text know justice because they say the vineyard owner will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the fruit in their season. What do we confess at the beginning of every divine service? Yeah, the triune name of God. But what do we confess? Do all your sins justly deserve nothing but God's punishment, now and forever? The punishment your sin deserves, both temporal and eternal punishment, God will deliver. Actually, in fact, God, the God of all creation, has poured out his damnation already, once and for all. But it's not on you. It's on his son at the cross. God's wrath against you has been satisfied by the son. In our text, Jesus reminds what God had long promised. He quotes this beautiful poetry from Psalm 118. Have you never read in the scriptures? The stone that the builders have rejected has become the cornerstone. This is marvelous. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Man's rejection of the stone gets overturned by God's new construction. Jesus' first hearers threw him out of the temple, and God says, "Great! I am building a new temple. And this is the stone on which I am going to construct it." Resurrection is marvelous to believers. What Jesus finished 2,000 years ago still is true today. His forgiveness, his life, and his salvation is still true today. Our day after day grief over our sin, at last God has put to death. Heart torn, we must confess that we have crucified the Christ. That is our confession. We did it. But the forgiveness of sins, the removal of grief, the cleanliness of heart, the new song that comes out of our mouth has been given to us to proclaim to our friends and our families, to ourselves, so that we will remain. Jesus wants his people to be faithful. And he warns of faithlessness. The one on whom this stone falls will be broken into pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. Anyone who trips over Jesus stumbles and will be shattered. And anyone who this Jesus rock falls on will be crushed. No one survives Jesus. And yet, our God is amazing because he is not the God who just crushes and kills. Our God kills and makes alive. Our God creates faith in his believers. He sends them the Holy Spirit working in you to believe in his Son, to believe in his truths. Did you hear the good news? Yes, many in the world will destroy the master's vineyards. Yes, they would make themselves to be beautiful and terrible gods. But God writes a new story. Jesus promises, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from those people and given to a producing people. The God who rules over all, who once chose old Israel to be his blessing to the rest of the world, did that. Some came. They shared their fruit. Some. Today, And the God of all creation has chosen you through his word and sacraments to be his new Jerusalem, his new Israel, his new people, to be a blessing to all who come into your life, and not just with money, but with Christ. The Son has risen to life again. Rejoice in his resurrection. Rejoice in his vineyard. Rejoice, for he has called you to work today and tomorrow and eat of the shares of the vineyard and give of your shares of the vineyard. Eat of his word and give of his word, because the resurrection is coming. Rejoice in the harvest that is to come. So as long as today is called today, let us produce the fruits of God's vineyard for his resurrection harvest. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen. I would have you now open your bulletin and find the prayer and blessing that we will be speaking over these quilts and backpacks for God's use out there in the world. So it's the litany for hands and feet, and I will lead us, and then you will speak the responses. Gracious God, you create light in the darkness. You saw that light was good and separated it from all that was darkness. And so that we might be a living light among one another for you,
we are the hands and feet of Christ in your world.
God, you created the very idea of home in a world of chaos, the place where we feel safe, the place where we receive your peace. You lead us to share this peace with one another and with the world. Give us the peace found and following the one you sent to lead us out of our darkness of sin, Christ Jesus.
We are the hands and feet of Christ in your world.
God, you gave grace so that we might endure the world and its evil. Grace for us in giving us love even when we are not perfect. Grace for one another when we offend and when we commend. Grace for a world who receives it. When we share your grace with the broken world,
we are the hands and feet of Christ in your world.
Gracious God, we ask that you take these earthly gifts prepared for the world, use them to shine your light in someone's darkness. We ask that you use them to make known your comfort as they sit in darkness. We ask that you use them as your grace so that your love can live through us to them, as we are the hands and feet of Christ in your world. Amen. We rise now for the prayers of the church. In our prayers, we have a few additions. One is for Ron and June Clawitter, who are suffering with COVID. This is Catherine Manhart's mother and father, so we'll be praying for them to have recovery, but also for two families, the family of Connie Telschow and the family of Clara Lenora Price. Connie is the friends of Cara Nabok, who passed away of cancer, and mother of five who passed away recently with cancer. And Clara is Mike Price's mother, and so we'll be praying for their comfort and peace during this time. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and all people according to their needs. O Lord, you have planted, nurtured, and hedged around your vineyard the church. You sent your dear Son to give her his life for her. Inspire her by your Holy Spirit to yield much fruit for your kingdom, and grant that many may find shelter on her holy hill. Direct our zeal toward your good and gracious purpose of sharing the gospel of Jesus through pastors, professional church workers, lay church workers, through parents and friends. Prosper the work of our hands that our labor would produce faithful people that follow and believe in you. Lord, in your mercy. Father of mercy, since your Son has made us his own by death, by his death, grant that we may share in his sufferings with confidence, and that we may also know the power of his resurrection. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty Savior, bring an end to all war and violence, especially in Ukraine and now in Israel. Guide and protect those who defend us against our enemies, those who preserve order against the threat of terror, those who sit in judgment over evildoers, that justice and peace may prevail, and that we may work together for the common good through your word and promises. Lord, in your mercy. God of all help, you hear the cries of the righteous and deliver them from their troubles and fears. Remember all who cry out to you for mercy, especially Peggy, Vicky, Catherine, Paula, Ron, Rita, Sam, John, Bill, Mikey, Charlotte, Bud and Eunice, Linda, Amy, Diane, David, Olga, Tom, Nikki, Joe, Ron, and June. And we especially lift up to you the family of Connie and Clara as these families mourn their passing. Remind them and raise up people into their lives that will comfort them with the resurrected life of Christ and the harvest to come at the end of the age. So fill them with this hopeful joy. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, you prepare our hearts to receive your body and blood in this Holy Supper. Strengthen us in faith and renew us in love by this Holy Communion. Bring us at last with all the saints to dwell in your everlasting presence. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Lord, you sing the song of your love over the vineyard of your church. Lift her united voice through your Spirit, that she in turn would freely praise you and praise your lavish grace and proclaim your salvation beyond her walls. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The congregation may be seated for the offering, and I encourage you to grab the attendance and guest books located in the center aisles, and please fill those out. Gracious Lord, we give you thanks that you again have provided for all the needs of your people and the needs of your church. So we pray that you would use this offering to benefit the glory of your name here at St. Paul's and throughout the world. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
We remain standing for the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, we hear the words of our Lord. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Welcome to the table of the Lord. rise, turning to page 211 for the Nuctaminis, the Song of Simeon. Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And receive his benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. All right, before we get going on our closing hymn, I see three girls up there. You got to pound it out, girls. Good and loud, or Grover, turn them up. That'll work too.
Thank you.
Congregation may be seated for a few brief announcements. Try not to cry at three girls singing. How beautiful. First, I'm going to come to the congregation, see if there's anything that needs to be brought forward.
I'd just like to remind everybody the community center is open, and that they have now started sign language classes on Wednesday at 1:30.
Oh, nice. The community center is open, and they have sign language classes going on Wednesdays.
1:30.
Thank you. Thank you, Beverly. Other announcements? Well, up top, Peggy. Oh, look at that. We have a mic. Okay.
Thank you. With today being Mission Sunday, as you guys can tell, we have the quilts, we have the school packs up, and thank you for praying the blessings over these items. But the Sunday school kids wanted to say thank you in a unique way, and so they have made a video with the help of Andrew to say thank you for all of your donations and being so supportive of these missions. So thank you.
Well, we're not going to play that video yet, Grover. Okay. Hold on. Yeah, that's the last thing. Good. Thank you, Peggy. Other announcements? All right. Miss Kelly.
So I've been talking with Pastor Matt about how we can bring the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod synodical activities, events, and concerns to our members. And so we decided, like, once a month, we would probably have a snippet of something from the Synod president or someone in the Synod or our district to just share some information. This week happens, or this month actually happens to be Pastor Appreciation Month. So we're going to share the Set Apart to Serve initiative after this video. It will be another short video about the Set Apart to Serve, which is bringing up church workers in our church body.
Excellent. Yeah, and they're also, they're looking for a person in our circuit who will go to circuit churches and encourage young boys and young men and older boys and men and women to be church workers. That's the initiative, because we have such a small number of church workers now. So we need that encouragement. So I'm looking at a lot of families with kids. Your kids are going to be pastors next year. That's just all it is. Okay. We're going to do it here. Other announcements? I do have one, and that is there's a voters meeting October 15th. That's next Sunday. We will be voting on the boards, board memberships and those kind of things. So if you haven't been addressed by somebody to be on a board and you'd like to, please inform the church. Or if you'd like to be on a board and don't know which one you ought to be on, come and talk to me or an elder, and we will get you situated and serving the Lord, pouring out your fruits, to say, right, on God's people. With that, we'll watch the videos. I'm going to say, go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Hi, I'm Karen. I'm representing the St. Paul Lutheran Sunday School. I'm here to say thank you for your donations of school supplies. This is our second year of making school kits for the Lutheran World Relief at St. Paul. Last year, we made 60 kits. This year, we were able to make 100 kits. Thanks for your donations. We want to show you what 100 kits look like.
Christians by our love, by our love, just still know we are.
great? Our Lutheran World Relief School Kids newscast from last year is still on our YouTube channel, if you would like to check that out. School kids from that video went all over the world, specifically to the Dominican Republic and Tanzania. Also, volunteers have been busy cutting fabric squares for quilts that will also be donated to the Lutheran World Relief. They were able to make 36 quilts. Isn't that great? We are going to be doing this again next year. If you would donate for next year, we are asking for heavier fabric for the school kit, bags along for the cotton fabric and bed sheets to use for the backing of the quilts. Thanks again for all your donations, and who knows how many school kits and quilts we donate next year.
I'm Jim Bonick, Executive Director of LCMS Pastoral Education, which includes leading the Set Apart to Serve Church Work Recruitment Initiative. Set Apart to Serve is a Synod-wide, comprehensive, multi-year, culture-changing initiative focused on raising up full-time church workers today and for years to come. Jesus said, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few." Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. He gives this command that all might hear the good news of Jesus Christ for life and salvation. Based on these words of Christ, Set Apart to Serve urges our congregations, schools, and families to intentionally encourage young people and adults to consider serving in a full-time church work vocation. These vocations are honorable and sacred. They are joyful ways to serve God and his people. Part of the work of the church in every generation from the time of Christ is to raise up church workers to proclaim the gospel today and for generations to come. Everyone in the church has a role and responsibility in this task. Pastors, teachers, DCEs, and all our commission workers, parents and grandparents, and every lay person in the congregation and school. Church work formation and recruitment takes place in the home, the local congregation, and the Lutheran day school. This formation and recruitment takes place at the font, in home devotions, in the preaching and teaching of God's word in the divine service, in the Lutheran classroom, in youth Bible study, in Sunday school, confirmation instruction, the Lord's Supper, vacation Bible school, chapel, and wherever God's word is taught and applied for our life and salvation. Through Set Apart to Serve, the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod supports and equips congregations, schools, and all LCMS entities so they can identify, form, recruit, and encourage future church workers to preach and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ until he comes again on the last day. We are all very busy. It can be hard to find the time and the resources that will help us do this vital work. That's why Set Apart to Serve offers resources to help you encourage young people and adults to explore opportunities to serve God full-time in his church. These resources help pastors, teachers, DCEs, parents, and other influential adults like you talk with youth and adults about becoming full-time church workers and supporting them as they pursue these wonderful vocations. These resources include FAQs, ways to encourage future church workers, conversation guides for talking with various age groups of youth, a guide to mentoring, a guide for job shadowing, a church work vocation Bible study, and much more. As youth enter their high school years, it is very healthy for them to be in a community of like-minded peers, especially within the Synod and other Lutheran youth. We're collaborating with many partners across the Synod to foster deeper connections for our youth as they get closer to making college and career decisions. These partners include the seminaries, especially Christ Academy and Vocatio, Concordia University Church Work Retreats, Higher Things, the LCMS Youth Gathering, and Lutheran Camps. Jesus said, "The laborers are few." There is a great need for full-time church workers to preach and teach the good news of Jesus Christ. Forming and recruiting these workers may seem like a huge task, but not so huge when we're all working together. Every congregation can seek opportunities to talk with their youth and adults about considering full-time church work. If every LCMS congregation sends one young person into church work, even every 3 or 4 years, we will supply our pulpits and classrooms for many years to come. As we create this culture of church work formation and recruitment together, I look forward to talking and praying with all of you about the important work of raising up the next generation of church workers who are set apart to serve.